Welcome to a real quick course interview of overview rather of grade 11 applied mathematics. So this is in accordance with the new 2009-2011 curriculum. They've actually simplified it a lot. They've taken out consumer stuff. It's anyway, here's the what you're going to learn while you're with us. Here's what you should know to have the course, and here's what you're going to also learn on top of what you already should know. All right, next slide. Okay. So hopefully you're already familiar. The first unit we're going to do is quadratic functions. And it's called quadratic functions. That means square, funny enough. So we're going to look at things with squares in them. Hopefully you remember what x squared means. Hopefully you remember how to multiply a number by itself. Okay, so you're already familiar with lines. I hope you still remember lines. You can't have done a brain dump on linear functions. Linear functions are fairly straightforward. You know, things that are a linear relationship, you know, like you and your sister's age. Your sister's 2 years older than you. 5 years from now, your sister will still be 2 years older than you. 30 years from now, your sister will still be 2 years older than you. Every time you get 1 year older, your sister gets 1 year older. That's what a linear relationship is, pretty complicated. So of course you'd remember how to do y equals 2x minus 6, for example. Alright, and here's what y equals 2x minus 6 would look like. You plot that x, correction, that y-intercept there, the blue dot at the bottom. And then every time you go over one step, you go up 2, up over 1, up 2, over 1, up 2. And you make another blue dot, and zing, there's your line. So you get your y-intercept there at negative 6. This is all stuff you should know already, right? Because this is old news. And you got your x-intercept, looks like it's at 1, 2, 3 to the right, and 0. So it looks like it's plus 3. And it looks as though the slope is, well, remember that's that rise over run stuff. So it's 2 steps up every time you make 1 step to the right, so it's 2. Okay, and you could have done a table of values and all that stuff too. That's just lame. It's just easier to look at this equation and go zing like that. There you go. So hopefully you didn't do a brain dump on that stuff. Next slide. All right, now what we're going to be learning is hopefully also you're familiar with the TI-83, the Texas Instruments Graphing Calculator. All right, you should have had about 15 or 20 hours of monkeying around with that over the last couple grades. All right, it looks like that. Hopefully you've seen this machine before. It is a dream, and you're going to fall in love with this. And you get to use it all the time in applied math. All right, you get to use technology in applied math. All right, if you got a fancy app on your iPhone, use that too. I don't care. All right, well, I might put some restrictions on that, so I can't say I don't care, but we're going to be using lots of technology. If you're the type of person that doesn't like multiplying out long ways, I don't do it. I use a calculator. So make sure you got a calculator and you're going to learn how to use this one. The beauty of this one is that, look, it draws the lines for you. You type in an equation in here and then you go bing and it draws the line for you and tells you where all the points are on it and everything. Oh, hopefully you've been using it already. I hope. These calculators have been around for 20 years. My daughter's had them 20 years ago, for goodness sake. So hopefully you've seen them. If you haven't, I'd be a little concerned. All right, the next slide. Okay, so of course we're not going to be doing lines anymore. We're going to be doing those crazy shapes like this. Looks like a happy face. Looks like a sad face. Hey, this looks like when you throw a ball. Or it looks like when your son, you know, if you got a baby, when your baby boy pees, doesn't it? It looks as though, well, it's anything that flies through the air is going to follow that shape. And lots of things follow that shape. Trajectories, things that fly through the air. We're going to learn about this stuff. Notice these aren't lines. All right, lines are old news. You should know lines. These are better things. In fact, these are probably more important. The braking distance when you try to stop a car. All right, the braking distance when you try to stop a car depends on the speed times itself, the square of the speed. If you're going twice the speed limit, it takes you 4 times the distance to stop. Oh, yes, it does. Or else you kill yourself 4 times worse. One or the other. All right. So, never speed. It's kind of dumb. Or you'll learn how to maximize your profits. All right. So we'll be looking at these things. So maximizing your profits. Right there. You want to maximize your income. How much do you sell your Bannock for? Etc. So you're going to find this is rather important. We will learn about this, but I don't want to spend a lot of time going back through lines. Lines are pretty simple. All right. Now we're going to start putting squares on things. X squared. All right. All right. So what's up next? Next slide. Okay. Animate. So here's an example of what we will do. We will learn this. You ready? Here we go. So I'll give you something like y equals x squared minus 4, bada bing, bada boom, there's your x, there's your y, let's calculate a few of them here. Alright, I give you a 3, 2, 1, 0, I give you a few x's there, and all you're going to do is calculate them. Alright, you're going to calculate the y for each one of those x's, so let's see, 3 squared is 9 minus 4 is 5. Right, 2 squared is 2 squared, let's see, this 2, oh, I plot it there, alright. So a 3, 1, 2, 3 gets you 5. So 2 squared, let's see, 2 squared is 4 minus 4 is 0. So I go over 2 and up 0. So 2, 0. And I plot that puppy. So hopefully I remember how to plot. A picture is worth 1,000 numbers, that's what I always said. So a 1 gets you a negative 3. Well, let's see, a 1, 1 squared is 1, take away 4 is negative 3. Yep, so 1 gets you a negative 3 right there. Yep, bada bing, bada boom. And if you just keep doing, oh, you'll be doing lots of this in class. You'll find there's easier ways to do it. And, of course, that plastic brain does it too, that graphing calculator that you've likely seen before. Bing, there's that funny shape we're looking for, so we'll be doing lots of that stuff. Woohoo! All right. And, of course, look, the plastic brain does it for you too. You gotta love plastic brains. Kind of nice if you know how to use your own brain, but there comes a point where plastic brains do come in handy. So lots more of that on the TI-83. We'll be learning lots on the Texas Instruments 83 graphing calculator. I have lots of them. Don't go buy one, because they're like $120. All right? But get your own simple scientific calculator, though. All right? So go spend the $2 at Dollarama and get a simple scientific calculator. Next slide. So then we're going to be doing some scales and volumes and areas. So remember doing all that stuff in grade 10? I hope a lot of people don't like that stuff. Remember the volume of a cone? Remember the volume of a cone is 1/3 pi r squared times h? Yeah. All right, volume 1/3 pi r squared, because it's really just a circle. That's pi r squared multiplied by the height. It's really 1/3 of a cylinder, all that stuff. But hey, look what happens, though. So you had been calculating stuff like that. I would tell you the R, I would tell you the H. You'd plug those numbers into a calculator and boom, out would come the volume. All right, you know, like my six-year-old grandson can smash numbers in and hit equals. But what happens if you've got to do some algebra? What if you're told the R and the volume and you're asked how high is that cone? That's a different question. Now you've got to use everybody's favorite, algebra. Woohoo! All right, algebra. So we're going to be using those same formulas that you learned to love in grade 10, and we're going to monkey around with them a bit and learn how to solve equations with them. So if I said the volume was 355 milliliters, funny enough, that's what a can of Coke is, and say the radius of this cone was 6 centimeters, and then I said, so how high is that thing? Well, here's the type of math you would do. All right, we're going to learn how to do this, but it's really just algebra. All right, if you don't like algebra, well, we'll have about 2 days to review. And but there's the answer right there. It turns out that thing must be 9.41 centimeters high. And, of course, you get to use a calculator in applied math. All right, applied math. So get yourself a calculator. Make it a $2 one, preferably a $10 one, you know, where the buttons don't wear off. But get yourself a calculator, a scientific calculator with sine and cosine and tangent and x squareds and fun things like that. Next slide, engage. All right, then there's another unit we learned, proof and logic. So if everyone with brown eyes is cute, does that mean that everyone who's cute has brown eyes? Well, no, that's false logic. But don't worry, people will try to convince you with false logic all the time. So don't get messed up thinking that just because somebody says something, it's got to be true. they do try to twist their thoughts in your head around quite a bit. So don't get fished in with false logic. And we're going to do a lot of geometry to study logic. Because, funny enough, geometry is a very clear science. Everybody knows what a line is. Everybody knows what a circle is. There's no arguing about it. All right. So it's a lot easier to think logically when you're doing well-defined shapes than when you're discussing other more contentious issues. All right, so we'll tend to stick with geometric shapes and very basic understood concepts when we're doing logic. It's hard to discuss logic if you don't understand what a word means. Everybody knows what a circle is. Okay, so we're going to mix up proof, logic, geometry, all in the same sort of thing. Hopefully you've done a little bit of geometry and you know all these bits about transversals and alternate or vertical angles or being congruent and stuff like that. Angle A is equal to angle B is equal to angle C. That angle, that angle, that angle, that angle. They're all the same value, all right, if you measure them with a protractor, which you don't have to do because you know geometry. Right, so hopefully you did lots of geometry in grade 9. And 10. No, just 9, I guess. Anyway, let's keep going here. So this is the type of stuff we're going to do in grade 11 applied. So statistics. So you would have done lots of statistics in previous grades. Recall what those were? Mean, median, mode. You would have learned maybe as well the range as well. So what if you got a nursery school with kids in it, and there's a 2-year-old, a 2-year-old, a 3-year-old, a 5-year-old, a 5-year-old, a 5-year-old, and a 7-year-old? 7-year-old in nursery school, I don't know, whatever, all right? And you want to do some statistics, you know, a representative number. So, recall what the mean is. You just throw all the kids' ages in a hat and then divide them all out evenly so that everybody ends up being the same age. So you divide by 7, 4.14 is the mean. The median, remember, that's when you line the kids up in order, the youngest on the left, the tallest on the right, and then you find the middle one. So the middle one is 5, so that's called the median. So notice the mean, which is supposedly an average number, is not quite the same as the median, which is supposed to be like sort of like an average number. And you might recall that the mode is really just the number that comes up the most often. So you got lots of 5-year-olds, so you could say, well, most of my guys are 5 years old. So there's 3 different ways to explain. There's 3 different statistics that you can use to explain the central number that represents your group of data or people or whatever. And of course you learned how to graph it as well. So you would have done all the stuff before, so you'd graph it like that in some sort of pretty bar graph. And guess what? There's computers that do this too. Alright, maybe you already did it on the TI-83 as well. If not, we'll do some of that. Don't worry, let's go next slide. All right, so what we're going to learn, though, is the normal distribution. All right, so we're going to learn about the normal distribution, because it's amazing how often that this shape governs everything in your life. All right, that shape is kind of important. For example, you know, maybe the bus arrives, maybe there's the time the bus arrives. Say it, we'll call it exactly on the hour. So sometimes the bus is 1 minute late or 2 minutes late, but usually it's pretty much right bang on time. Sometimes it's 3 minutes early, -3. Sometimes it's 3 minutes late, +3. So by using this curve, it's amazing how often in our actual life this curve pops up. You know, it's not very often the bus is 4 minutes early, and it's not very often the bus is 4 minutes late. So you can actually use this curve to calculate what the chance is that you're going to miss school, all right? And it's you probably do in your head all the time. You just never knew it. So how about when you go buy a toaster at Best Buy or something? If we know the average toaster fails at 3 years, give or take 1 year, all right? So 3 years, give or take 1 year. So in other words, we know the average toaster fails right there at 3 years, give or take one. So it might fail at 4 years. It might fail at 2 years. So, do you bother buying the warranty or what? I don't know. Usually it's not a good idea, by the way, but it's up to you. So, what is the chance your toaster will last longer than, so greater than, 5 years? In other words, what's the chance it's going to, let's see, not fail at 3, 4, it's going to go 5 or more years long? Well, you know what the chances are. They don't make toasters that last 5 years anymore, do they? It turns out we'll learn the math, but it turns out this little tail here, this little bit, the number of toasters, you know, like every toaster in the universe is represented in this curve, and the number of ones that actually make it past 5 years is really like about 2.5%. All right? So there's a 2.5% chance your toaster's going to make it for 5 years. I've never had one go that long. Okay, next slide. So there's another unit we're going to learn. We are going to learn that. That'll be new to you. All right? That's called the normal distribution. And I'm just giving you a real quick overview of all this stuff, all right? This isn't the lesson. We got 110 hours to do this stuff. Next slide. And you'll have a research project, all right? So you get to write a biography on one of your favorite mathematicians. Not me, of course. Or you could write maybe a lesson plan on some subject, or I haven't figured out what we're going to really do on this yet. This is all new curriculum. So, you might want to write about the world population, you might want to do your own statistical survey and report on it, do some pretty bar graphs, and, you know, tell us what the average shoe size is of all the students, and lots of bar graphs and statistics, and calculate the chance that the next person to walk into the room has a size 12 or more shoe, etc. Or you might want to write about somebody like Pythagoras or something like that. There you go. So that's another subject there. There's 7 different subjects we do. This is the fifth unit, next unit. Systems of linear inequalities. What the heck do I mean by systems of linear equalities? Well, you already know what a linear equality is, right? That's a linear equation. So when I said 2x take away 5y equals 10, remember you did this in grade 10. And you went like that, bada bing, bada boom, you calculated the intercept, zip, and there's what it looked like. So there, that's kind of old news. All right, we're not going to spend a lot of time reviewing that, so hopefully you had that sufficiently on board. Now we're going to learn about inequalities, right? In means, like, inflammable. That doesn't make sense. Anyway, inequalities, that means they're not the same as equalities, all right? That's your greater thans and your less thans and all that, okay? So let's do that, and here's what we're going to do. So let's say I send you to the store, and I say, go get us 10 donuts. And, of course, the store's only got chocolate and maple, okay? Ugh, who eats maple anyways? So I send you to the store, I say, go get us 10 donuts. Well, actually, I say, get us no more than 10 donuts. So up to and including 10 donuts. So, and bring us back maple and chocolate. So up to 10. Not more than 10, just 10 or less. All right, so here's all your possibilities. Maple, chocolate, total. You know, you could have 1 and 9. You might have 2 maple, 8 chocolate, 3 maple, 4 chocolate, etc. I said no more than 10, though. So you might get 8 and 1, because that's a total of 9. 9's not more than 10, so you're doing what you're told. All right, so what are all the possibilities? Well, here's all the possibility if I said bring us back 10. If I said bring us back 10, here's all the possibilities. The maples plus the chocolates equals 10. It'd be a line like this, right? It could be 0 maple, 10 chocolate, 5 maple, 5 chocolate, 0 chocolate, 10 maple. It could be 3 maple, 7 chocolate, right? So there's M plus C equals 10. That's if I said make the donuts exactly 10. But what if I said no more than 10? All right, this is just an intro. We're going to take a week to learn this stuff. Well, guess what? The answer isn't just a line. The answer is actually a region. Ooh, you get to get out colored pencils and color in areas. Because any combination in any of that area there, even 0 chocolate and 0 maple, anything in this feasible region is an allowed solution. So it's not just one answer. Sometimes the answer to a mathematical question isn't just one number. Sometimes it's a bunch of numbers. Ooh, sneaky. So we're in looking for the entire region. What's the last unit we do here? Trigonometry. Everybody loves trigonometry. You know what? It's just a triangle, for goodness sake. All right, so let's study triangles. All right, so you've already done all kinds of crazy stuff like a squared, b squared equals c squared, right? There's a squared, b squared equals the big side squared, and, right? We're not going to go through that stuff again. And so you've already done lots of that and lots of SOHCAHTOA, I hope. And so then if I give you a right angle triangle with a side 5 and a side 8, here's your right angle, and I say, so, tell me what that x is. Well, you just use Mr. Pythagoras, and it comes up being square root of E9 or something like that. And if you're in this class in applied, you're allowed to round it to 9.43 if you want. And by the way, in pre-cal, don't ever let me catch you rounding a square root. I will freak out, all right? But in applied math, you're allowed to use a calculator to calculate what the square root of 89 is. All right, and then I ask you for what this angle is here, too. So this is old news. Hopefully you recall some of this, or you will with about an hour of review. So you do the inverse tan of 5/8, opposite over adjacent. And our ancestors calculated that for us 2,000 years ago, and they calculated it was 32 degrees, and you'd break down 32 degrees. All right, so you've done lots of that. Now, where does it get different for us? Well, when we do trigonometry in grade 11 applied, we're going to start, what happens if there's no square corner? Because so far, you've done the SOHCAHTOA, but that only works with square triangles. What happens if you don't have a right angle triangle? How would you find x in this triangle? Let's see, there's 110. I don't see any 90 degree corners in that puppy. 6, 7, x, how are we going to do that? I don't know. Well, except for the fact, of course, that any triangle is really two right angle triangles. But let's pretend we don't know that. So it's easy, actually. So here's what you say. You say the x squared is the 6 squared plus the 7 squared minus 2 times the 6 times the 7 times the cosine of the angle in between the 6 and the 7. And you just smack all these numbers into a computer. You're allowed to do that. And then you hit boom, and it tells you the answer is 10.66. Pretty simple. There you go. Don't worry. We'll spend about 4 hours doing that stuff, too. All right. That's called the cosine law. I find that people, the more complicated a formula is, the more people like it. It's really weird. So you'll actually love this. It's kind of handy, too, especially if you're going to be a carpenter building rafters or something, or landscaping, or anything, where you're making stuff. You're going to want to know this. Anyway, that's something we will learn, but it's still based on basic trigonometry, and we'll also learn it in the context of the trigonometry unit talks about going around a circle, too. So if that's you on a Ferris wheel right there, say at the Red River X, so you're on a Ferris wheel, and you're going around, usually you go around that way when we talk about going around circles. So let's say you're 5 meters above, and you're 2 meters to the left of the center of this circle, of this Ferris wheel. So we'd say, well, what's your angle, and what's your distance? And you could calculate all that. So really, we're going to start looking at triangles, because can you see that there's really a triangle here? Notice this triangle here. And you see that there's really a triangle inside that circle. So it's kind of, you're able to actually calculate circles by studying triangles. Weird, eh? All right, so, yeah. Anyway, that's the type of thing we'll do there. So we'll learn that. So there, that's pretty much an overview of everything you're going to do on this course. You might have, if you understand all that, we'll just give you the test right now and off you go. All right, so here. So, to conclude, you'll hopefully recall that lots of your previous math. So hopefully you remember how to use a calculator and get one, in fact. Hopefully you remember your SOHCAHTOA, your trigonometry, your algebra, your solid figures, your formulas, you know, like pi r squared h and 4/3 pi r cubed for balls and blah, blah, stuff like that. You'll be able to look it up on a cheat sheet anyways, all right? We'll spend a couple days reviewing previous math, but I'm not going to be teaching grade 9 and 10 math in grade 11, right? If you've done a complete brain dump, you're going to want to bust a gut. So hopefully you recall your previous math, and you will be using technology. So you'll definitely be using a calculator. Get your own calculator. $2 at Dollarama, as long as it's a scientific calculator. It's got a sine and a cosine and tangent and x squareds and logs and things like that on it. All right? Or preferably spend $10, because otherwise the paint wears off the buttons. The $2 ones are kind of cheap, but they will work. And, yeah, and we'll have my really fancy calculator in the classroom. And if we get a chance, we'll do some Excel and stuff like that in a computer lab. kit, but get yourself a scientific calculator. So there's pretty much the entire course. So now you get the idea, sort of roughly, of what you should still remember and what you are going to learn. And, you know, enjoy the course. That's it. Briefing's complete. How do I stop this thing? There we go.